And so London is one of those places where you see all the symbolism of the Knights Templars, just like Switzerland. And so let's have a quick look at the Canton flags of Switzerland first.
All of these Swiss cantonal flags, St. Gallen, Bern, Ticino, Uri, Aargau, and then Basel, Stadt, Geneva, Vaud, Glarus, I think one of these is the Athensels, Neuchâtel, Solothurn, Zug, Obwalden, Ticino again, Switzerland, Ticino, Switzerland, blah blah blah. And here is Basel Land, Schwyz, Zürich, Nidwalden, Wallis, Schaffhausen, Jura, Inner Appenzell, Fribourg, the Grisons, or Graubünden as they call them in German, Luzern, and Thurgau.
And so just as they have the Canton flags in Switzerland, likewise in London we see the flags of the Knights, and there's no better place to see this than at the coronation of the Queen.
In a welcome of bells, the Queen arrives at Westminster.
High up in the Henry VII chapel hang the banners of chivalry, the banners of the Knight's Grand Cross of the Order of the Bath, gold and crimson, green and gold and blue, in the figures of heraldry. The Golden Lion of England, the Red Lion of Scotland within the double treasure, Flory, Counter Flory, the Black Eagle with wings outstretched upon an ermine field, a red rose barbed and seeded, the sun in his golden splendor, out of the fan vaulting of the roof. The five swords of state, three of which are carried in procession before the Queen. Two swords of justice, and the sword of mercy with the blunted point. And the window dedicated to the few, those 63 squadrons which fought the Battle of Britain. Their badges all recorded here, in the colours of the glass, against the sky they defended.
And so at the coronation we saw lots of knights riding on horses, as you'd expect at a Templar occasion. And inside Westminster Abbey we see the stained glass windows were dedicated to all the squadrons of the Royal Air Force, and not to Jesus Christ and the disciples. And we saw the flags of chivalry, as they're called in England, and we saw the black and white squares and the phoenix and all the symbols of Freemasonry and of the Knights Templars. And in the background, the song Jerusalem was playing, which is something that's very dear to the Knights Templars, because all the Crusades were about capturing the city of Jerusalem and also the Temple of Solomon, which was once there. And to rebuild that Temple of Solomon today is the central cause of Zionism. And the principal person in control of the coronation was Prince Philip, the Queen's husband. And he, of course, is a leading Freemason. And the coronation ceremony takes place on Edward's chair, that is King Edward Longshanks, who evicted the Jews from England in 1290 AD. And this chair has underneath it a stone which is believed to be the old cornerstone of the Temple of Solomon. And so this is a sacred stone to the Knights Templars, and this is where the coronation takes place. And the Queen then sat down and took a number of oaths. And so let's have a look at the oaths that the Queen took.
The Queen now compacts with her people and before them to govern according to the laws and customs of her realms.
Madam, is your Majesty willing to take the oath?
I am willing.
Will you solemnly promise and swear to govern the people of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, the Union of South Africa, Pakistan, and Ceylon, and of your possession and the other territories to any of them belonging or pertaining, according to their respective laws and customs?
I solemnly promise so to do.
Will you, to your power, cause law and justice in mercy to be executed in all your judgments?
I will.
Will you, to the utmost of your power, maintain the laws of God and the true profession of the gospel? Will you, to the utmost of your power, maintain in the United Kingdom the Protestant Reformed religion established by law? Will you maintain and preserve inviolable the settlement of the Church of England and the doctrine, worship, discipline, and government thereof as by law established in England? And will you preserve unto the bishops and clergy of England and of the churches there committed to their charge all such rights and privileges as by law do or shall appertain to them or any of them?
All this I promise to do.
And so we all may have believed back in 1953 that Christianity was going to thrive in London, but London ever since has become one of the least Christian cities in the world.
When Nazi Germany attacked Britain in 1940, Winston Churchill called on his people to defend Christian civilization. Today there is a new kind of battle in Britain, and Christianity is again at stake. Dale Hurd reports from London.
The coronation of Queen Elizabeth. Like British monarchs before her, she promised to maintain the laws of God and the true profession of the gospel. But Britain today is at war with the gospel and with itself. Christians who try to be Christians in the workplace risk being demoted or fired, and the government continues to push an aggressive gay rights agenda while threatening to criminalize Christian speech and practice. Christian politician and activist George Hargraves.
Yesterday, I got a letter from the Advertising Standards Authority of a complaint saying that my billboard that says Britain is a Christian country is offensive to atheists and other religions, and it incites hatred against them. What nonsense. Britain is constituted as a Christian country. Daily prayers are said in Parliament, whether atheists like it or not. The Queen is the head of the Church of England and therefore has to acknowledge God for her sovereignty over the nation. These things are written into not just our culture and our heritage, but into our constitution.
Great Britain is officially a Christian nation, and in fact, at one time was the missionary base for the entire world, even sending missionaries to the new American colonies. But Britain today in practice is increasingly anti-Christian, and the cases of anti-Christian bigotry and discrimination are beginning to pile up. In response, Christian legal centers have mobilized. Lawyer Andrea Minicello Williams of Christian Concern for Our Nation warns that if British Christians don't step up now, Britain is on a path to criminalize the practice of Christianity in public.
There's been a massive move by the secularist lobby to privatize religion. You can have faith so long as it doesn't affect you in the workplace, so long as you don't bring it into the workplace. Just make it private. It can't be public. It can't affect what you do in the public square.
Christian Quabena Pete was forced to attend homosexual sensitivity training at work, administered by a lesbian.
One of the things that she said was when she asked the question, what makes you all think that to be heterosexual is natural? At which point I walked out.
He then wrote a letter to the sensitivity trainer explaining the Bible's position on homosexuality and that God loved her and he loved her. He was suspended.
They said that by me telling them about the word of God, it's constituted harassment and intimidation.
Quibena was just recently reinstated. Cases like Quibena's are repeated over and over in Britain. Doctors, nurses, adoptive parents, deemed unfit because of their Christian beliefs. Christians are told not to speak about God in the workplace, or they're punished for offending homosexuals or Muslims. Now the British government wants to pass a new equality bill that would force churches to hire practicing homosexuals or transsexuals. Christian lawyer Paul Diamond has been very successful in fighting Christian discrimination cases in the courts.
In the United Kingdom, the homosexual agenda is militants, and they've been arresting Christians, jailing Christians for hate crimes, shutting off grants, constant litigation with the government, constant aggression. There's no live and let live. Your Christian values are wicked and evil, and that's what they want everybody to believe.
And so the British royal family today are very much the product of the English Revolution.